broadcast for shooters, hunters, and gun enthusiasts. This is the Firearms Radio Network. The bandwidth for this episode of the AR-15 podcast is sponsored by Patriot Patch Company, patriotpatch.co.
Welcome to the AR-15 podcast. This is the podcast about your favorite black rifle. This show is for you. Whether you're building your first AR or you've been building ARs for years, there is something we can all do to take our black rifle to the next level.
You make this show possible by clicking through our Brownells and Amazon affiliate links. The next time you order online, go to AR15podcast.com and click through our Brownells and Amazon affiliate links. It doesn't cost you anything extra, and a small portion of your sale goes to supporting pro-gun radio like the AR-15 podcast.
Well, hello, everybody. Thanks for joining us for another podcast. Tonight, we're doing episode number 164 of the AR-15 podcast. And in this episode, we're going to talk about all things AR pistol. So, JD, how are you doing today?
Doing pretty good. Spent some time out in the desert shooting and spent some time with my son and a friend. It's always a great way to blow off the stress from a long work week to shoot some lead down range and spend some time with some good people. So, doing well. You?
I'm good. Now, so tell me about these desert jaunts. This isn't like a old, Kwai Chang Kang desert, journey where you're just kind of drifting through the sand dunes. It's a little more structured, right?
Actually, it's not. Basically, there's several areas. There's basically a no-shoot box. It's around the Las Vegas Valley that you have to adhere to. So there's several ranges you can go to. I like the freedom of going out into the desert sometimes. And basically, you head out past the no-shoot box, and you pull off some of the old dirt roads that they got out there. And the harder the place is to get into, and if you have to get in with a four-wheel drive, the better, because the less amount of people that are out there. So it's finding a beautiful spot in the desert where you got a safe backstop, and you're able to pick up your brass and basically leave it as untouched as you possibly can and enjoy. It was beautiful today, like 72 and sunny with just a little bit of wind. So it's probably as close to heaven for me as I can find out here in the desert.
You know, my problem with going out to any of the places I shoot on a regular basis that are have that kind of freedom is that the brass drops in vegetation and disappears forever. I know that there are many places where archaeologists are going to think that a small firefight occurred, but it's lost to me. I'll never be able to find it again.
You know, I actually they have a new accessory that takes care of that problem, Reed. He was born about 10 and a half years ago. His name is Jeremy. Tell him to pick up the brass and everything, and he does it. And we complained about it once, and I said, do you know how much one of these costs, one of these bullets? And now he's just happy he gets to go out for free and knows he has to load mags and pick up brass, and that's his payment. So that's how he pays for the ammo. So you got to, train up a child, Reed.
I hear you. I have to figure out which one of mine can accomplish the task. Well, I haven't really had many opportunities to get out and do anything because, of course, it's my busy season. So I'm going to just kind of, power through it and then have like a, complete range excursion as a day off when it's all said and done. Well, so why don't you let our listeners know about our listener meetup here before we segue on to the rest of the show today.
We're going to do a NRA show meetup. It's going to take place at the Cardinal Hall of Fame Saturday, May 21st at 7 p.m. That's the Cardinal Hall of Fame Saturday, May 21st, 7 p.m. The firearms radio crew that's going to be out there will be there. Jake says, I'm going to murder this again. If they can say ambidextrous,
No. That's spelled ambidextrous.
Ambidextrous.
Yeah, I think that's the way Jake says it. Ambidextrous.
as well, Jake will buy you a drink. So I'm not sure if Ambi will get you that drink.
That would be Amber.
Amber. I'm trying my best here. I talk for a living. I don't spell or read for a living. So if you can check that out, it would be a great time to meet some of your favorites that are going out there for the NRA show meetup, Cardinal Hall, the Cardinal Hall of Fame Cafe, Saturday, May 21st at 7 p.m. I don't know if JW's heading out there. I'm not sure. Reed, are you going to be in that area?
You know, I don't know. It's all up in the air at this point. We are just going to have to kind of keep ourselves in a holding pattern and see what, you know, breaks loose. If something breaks loose, I may very well be out there.
Okay.
So we'll see.
I spent all my travel budget for SHOT Show, so. That the gas 5 miles down to where the convention center was, it just broke me for the rest of the year. So.
Well, why don't you tell the listeners about the giveaway that has officially begun? It's exciting news.
It is. We have teamed up with New Frontier Armory in North Las Vegas to provide one of their 9mm carbine rifles for a giveaway. It is really cool to see us able to partner with a up-and-comer like New Frontier. I have been doing business with them as just a customer for 6 years. Their customer service has been phenomenal, and I've experienced that also on this side. I've never put so much work into a rifle that I don't get to keep. So it has been an awesome experience. We were going to launch it on April 1st, but the more I got to think about it, I did not want to launch a rifle giveaway on April Fool's. So we set it off on the 31st, already approaching about 200 people to sign up. You know, we're going to do this by the book. It's going to go from FFL to FFL. There's going to be no funny business. You're going to have to be of legal age to own a rifle. We will work as best we can with those in California. David from New Frontier Armory, the owner, really didn't bat an eyelash about California or any of the other restrictive states except for New York. If you're listening in New York, we invite you to sign up. If you win, we'll have to work something out about you purchasing one of the, I believe it's non-featured stocks that kind of looks like something a Klingon would use in Star Trek. And you put it on a rifle, and it means you're able to have it in the state of New York. We welcome you to sign up, and we will be willing to work that out, too. You can get the link at our show notes. It is in episode 164 show notes there. You can also find it on our Facebook page, facebook.com/AR15podcast. And also, if you're to go to firearmsradio.tv and click on the AR15 podcast show link, there will be a link right there. Sign up. Listen to the show. Just a couple house cleaning things with it. Multiple entries, you're going to get one, and that's it. It's kind of fair for everybody. We've got a pretty stacked calendar this year. We're trying to do some really cool things. So at the end of this giveaway, we can't wait 30 days for somebody to respond. So we're basically going to give about 72 hours. We have your information. We will be calling and emailing, sending smoke signals, messenger ponies, whatever we have to do to get a hold of you in that 72 hours and get you vetted and make sure everything's all good. If we can't get a hold of you, if you happen to be in, you know, Iran and you're on a vacation there and you just don't have the Wi-Fi signal or something, we're going to move on. We can't be holding on to this because we've got, you know, this is just the start of what is going to be an amazing 2016 for the AR-15 podcast. So know that it'll run till May 31st. We'll be announcing a winner very quickly after that. We have contest rules if you want to check them out. Everybody just generally.
May 31st?
May 31st.
3 months, not 2 months.
I wanted to do 3 months. Then you look at the calendar and you're like, something's got to give here a little bit.
All right. So, guys, you have 60 days. 60 days to get in here and get it done. And you know what? JD brings up a good point. So, here's the thing. We are giving away a rifle. It's going through FFLs. Everybody understands the time that we live in, but we're not going to entertain silly names. We're asking for a first name and a last name. We need to vet you. You're going to give us your email address, your telephone number. You have to be a real live breathing human being. And, you know, your name really isn't Mother Effer or, you know, Big Mother Effer or, you know, Big Kahuna Mother Effer. I mean, that's just not your name. And that's not who it's going to be transferred to. And we're going to transfer the rifle to the name that's in the entry. And that's the double check. That's how we make sure that everything's above board, that everything is safe, and that everything is proceeding legally. So, guys, cut it out. Be serious. This is a rifle. You know, this isn't some airsoft toy.
Those entries probably are going to get kicked out. So if you yourself did that, please go back and enter again with the legit information, because if that is the thing that's pulled, I can't transfer it to that name. I am not going to waste the guys at New Frontier Armory's time to transfer that. So, man, this is a really cool opportunity. And, you know, 99.9% of us, we all play by the rules and everything's good. It's that couple of people who think that'll be funny. And yes, I laughed, but it is not the time for that. So get the entries in. You got less than 60 days now. This will be the first of what we're hoping will be several pretty cool partnerships that we will have this year that we're bringing to you. Reed and I are not qualified or eligible to win the rifle. No matter what you guys on Facebook think, it's not going to be the first person that sends Reed $500 or a pair of one-of-a-kind rare iron sights. I mean, he would appreciate all that stuff. And if you'd like, you know, a P.O. box to send it to, we can make that happen. But it is going to be a randomized number thing. We're going to take 10 winners and we will go down the list. If we can't contact the first 9, then number 10 is the lucky winner. So all the contest rules, everything at firearmsradio.tv. Click on the AR-15 podcast link or check out the show notes in episode 164, the AR-15 pistol episode. I think we've covered everything. I don't know if we have to do the little quick legal disclaimer real quick, but you guys get it.
Nah, we'll get it all on the internet for you. All right. Well, so we've been talking about this show for a little bit here. And so today is a good opportunity to get it in and have a discussion about it, because I think that I've seen some buzz. We have some things that are potentially going to impact this in the near future. And so I think it's a relevant topic, but we're going to talk about the AR-15 pistol. And so, you know, I think most of our listeners, JD, are probably rifle, you know, connoisseurs. If they have pistols, I'm sure most everybody knows how to shoot and carries pistols. They're traditional pistols. You know, if they have, you know, excellent taste like me, then they carry SIGs. But when it comes down to it, the AR-15 in a pistol configuration is something that we've never really explored, I don't believe. And I've slept since I've done all of the other podcast episodes, but I don't think we've explored this in the same way or in any real way yet. So let's kind of jump in here, and we're going to start off with what the differences are between an AR pistol and an AR rifle. So what do you think of when you think of an AR pistol in terms of that kind of differentiation there, JD?
I think of something that's built to be, you know, when I think of a pistol, I think of more compact, able to be maneuvered with, not as long and bulky as a rifle. So when I think of an AR pistol, I think definitely smaller, something that's a more compact package, but offers the same caliber as what an AR-15 would.
Right. And then, of course, within a certain I think, well-defined parameter, you're going to probably be able to do the same conceptual build in a pistol caliber round and be good. Although I don't think you're likely to ever go up the AR-10 into the AR-10 family of rifles and be able to have what would be anywhere near an enjoyable experience in terms of a pistol caliber AR-10. But I'm sure someone has done it. That's just not, you know, fodder for today's show. So, you know, I think one of the things that is really critical to the idea that you're going to go out and build an AR-15 pistol is lower receiver. And, you know, I did a little bit of research today. I'm not certain whether the internet Google foo is with most of our listeners when they try to look into this, but I have a particular penchant and some resources that are available to me. So, you know, going back, I think the earliest reflection I have on the issue of building a pistol out of a rifle-oriented receiver is a 92 BATF letter from the technical division, technical branch, on a request from, I believe it was a firearms manufacturer, trying to answer the question of could they build a pistol out of a pre-existing manufactured receiver. And theirs was, of course, at that time, oriented towards the bolt action receivers. And the ATF letter basically pointed out that, well, if it had been a rifle and it was converted into a pistol configuration, it was a no-go without the appropriate SBR process being undertaken. However, if it was a receiver that had never been built into a rifle, you had essentially a tacit green light from the ATF from this very limited letter to go forward. And understand that a letter, an ATF letter from in this context is very much like an IRS letter ruling. A private letter ruling is something that is not definitive. It's not law. It cannot be relied on for another person in another set of facts, however similar they may be, because it's another time. And so, you know, the idea that you would do this based on that one letter would be kind of foolish if you were going to be a manufacturer, because of course, putting large resources into this idea might put you in a very negative place. But it does give some guidance as to where the ATF is in their thinking. And of course, the insiders look at these letters and the flow of these rulings and try to gauge what they are saying as they evolve to divine where the ATF is moving with certain thoughts internally. So the idea was essentially that as long as it had never been a rifle, you would be complying with the definition of a handgun, which was something that was originally built or originally conceived of or originally intended to be a pistol. And so the idea, and I think I've seen some general consensus among the pundits that they think that this is some pixie dust ruling, but I think to me it makes a little more sense because it's about intent. And, you know, it's a very big thing in a lot of aspects of law. You know, if the intent was that it was to be a receiver upon which a pistol was built, then it cannot be called a rifle because it was never intended to be a rifle, and therefore it's okay. Now, how far back do you go to find the intention? You know, not to give the ATF any ideas because I know they've already had it, but if it was me, the intention would be, you know, firmly rooted in the on the shoulders of the manufacturer. And so I would feel comfortable if a manufacturer said I made this, you know, run of 1,000 lowers to be pistols and this run of 1,000 lowers to be rifles and sold them as such, and they were transferred as such. That would make me comfortable. You know, if it's just an unaddressed, never been done anything with, lower receiver, transferred into the hands of my FFL, and I told him it was a pistol, and that's how it came to me. I'm not all that comfortable with that idea. But, you know, that's the way that I think a lot of these things are transferred right now. Everybody looks kind of at the 44-73 as the de facto point at which someone has made the observation that it is either A or B. You know, it's the old Schrodinger's cat. That's when they just open the box and told you what it is. That being the case, it's the way it's done these days. I don't think you're going to buck the system until something comes down from the ATF that compels people to move off of it. So let's kind of move on to some of the kind of nuts and bolts of an AR pistol. You know, obviously, there are a lot of the components that the pistol is going to be built on that we're all already familiar with. And so, I mean, JD, we got the receivers. We've got our lower parts kits. We have our handguards. We have bolts. We've got our grips. And so that kind of creates the core of our rifle, but we have some issues with the buffer tube and the barrel. And I mentioned the barrel only as much as if you're building rifles, you're not building anything shorter than 16 inches. And so when we put the pistol configuration on the table, we have a lot more flexibility in terms of barrel length. And so now we can start getting into much shorter barrels. And that does affect our choices in some of these components, because you're going to be impacted by the gas system. You're going to be impacted by, if you go piston, the piston system. You're impacted by your handguards, because now we're not putting 15-inch handguards on that thing. And the buffer tube. The traditional buffer tube on an AR pistol is one that is configured, manufactured in a way that it is not capable of readily accepting a traditional stock. You look puzzled, JD.
Well, no, I'm just, when I look at the buffer tube for an AR pistol, as I'm looking at one right now in Brownells, I'm just thinking, how would I keep myself from not shouldering that? That's just the natural, that would be my natural instinct to do this. I see it's got a, foam covered on the back of the pad. This is a Phase 5 tactical AR-15 pistol buffer tube setup I'm looking at. And I'm just trying to figure out. I don't have one. I've shot one before. A friend has one. But I'm just trying to figure out how I wouldn't shoulder that. You know what I'm saying? How the difference, I get the difference, but to me it still looks like coming back that I'd still try to put that against my shoulder and try to shoot it like I would a normal AR.
I get that. I think that's one of the things that we're going to probably raise up a little later in the show, but I think it is a compelling point that you raise, when you're used to doing things one way, it's hard to basically divorce yourself from that experience. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's real hard to, put yourself in that completely different, frame of mind so that you can see it from another perspective. I do think that because of the nature of what we're talking about here, our flexibility is limited in a number of unique ways. When we have a rifle in the traditional sense of a rifle, I don't know that going shorter than 16 inches is a very big deal in terms of drivers, other than the fact that, like any 5-year-old, if you tell them that you cannot do something, we feel the compulsion to do it. And I am as guilty as anybody of feeling that compulsion. What do you mean I can't have a barrel shorter than 16 inches? I can. I have to jump through these hoops, but I can. Don't tell me I can't. But that's not always so easy for everybody else to jump through. But, you know, I think it's a traditional male 5-year-old response to being told you can't have something. You figure out a way to get it. But, you know, absent that, I don't know that it really comes up that often. Most rifle shooters are shooting the rifle in a pretty traditional context that you would want a rifle and aren't looking for the characteristics of a pistol in that utilization. So I don't know that it's something that we're driven to. But, you know, you go into the pistol, you know, caliber, or not the pistol caliber, the pistol format of an AR, and all of a sudden you have some severe limitations. You cannot have a stock on it. You're just not going to be able to put one on it. And frankly, from an operational standpoint, you know, at the moment in time that you take the stock away and you're trying to treat this AR as a pistol and you have a 20-inch barrel and, you know, a 15-inch handguard on it, it's not a very comfortable pistol. It's just not ever going to be so. So I think in that, you know, in that traditional, you know, assembly, in that traditional model of a pistol, you're going to have something under 16 inches. I think, you know, anywhere from, I don't know, I've seen 2-inch barrels to, you know, 10 and a half, 11-inch barrels. So, I mean, I think somewhere in that neighborhood, you're probably okay in terms of what choices are available. But, you know, really, you begin to have to deal with some of the complexities of customizing a rifle from the perspective of dealing with your gas system. You know, certainly you want it tamed as much as possible, because without all of that extra furniture to support your, you know, fundamentals, you're shooting a beast. And, you know, everything everybody hates about, you know, older pistols is, you know, kind of evident in the way it's conceived. You know, it has a very high bore axis. I don't think you could get any higher than the bore axis on an AR pistol because of the way it's designed. You're dealing with a, you know, buffer tube and a buffer and a bolt that are coming back and extended down an extended buffer tube, you know, well past the point you would have any interaction on a standard pistol in terms of its slide, you know, going through its travel. And so that is significantly going to affect recoil, follow up, you know, control, accuracy, a whole bunch of issues. So, you know, there are some limitations to the flexibility that you're going to find in a pistol build. That's not to say you're going to find a limit in choices. I think that they've got enough penetration in the market, and the drive to the SBR is supporting a number of kind of cross-compatible concepts. I think you're never going to run out of things that you can incorporate into a pistol build. But, you know, I think those are kind of the top level differences that you're going to find. JD, do you have any observations about the differences in that kind of high level view?
I mean, I think you hit them all there. You know, just I think that I'm really trying to put myself in a devil's advocate kind of thing, thinking that, you know, I would want one and to put it together. But I really, the differences really seem to be swaying me to even be hard to play that role, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
It just doesn't. The differences are such detractors for me, the ones you listed, that I wouldn't even probably proceed going through an AR pistol build at this point, unless we bring up something further along down the show that entices me or gives me a, I want to do this.
Then you know what? Let's move on to our next part here, our what's the point segment. So, you know, you want an AR-15 pistol. Why? What's the point of having an AR-15 pistol? Let's kind of talk about some of the top level things that came to mind. Certainly, if you guys, the listeners, come up with something that we haven't touched on, we'd love to hear you because, you know, I think this is kind of a hard one, and we'll get to that here as we go. But what's the point? So, you know, you get rifle power in a compact size. You know, let's say you can get an 8-inch barrel. Let's say you can get a 6-inch barrel on a 223. You can get it, you know, with a pistol-length gas system. Maybe even you can get it tamed with a, you know, one of those pigtail gas tubes, or you can get it tamed with stiffer springs or heavier buffer or more mass or whatever it is you're going to do to tune it and control it. You are shooting a rifle caliber projectile through a pistol. And that's a pretty powerful and compelling point.
You know, thinking about that, it's been probably 6 months now. Remember the home defense episode we did when we talked about the different calibers and how 223 responded in a home defense situation and going through it and actually responded pretty favorably.
Right.
I mean, that just seeing that, thinking about that rifle power in a compact size with an AR pistol, I mean, you would be able to have that maneuverability and that rifle power in a home defense situation. That would actually be a pretty good plus for me as I'm thinking about it here. Having that in that size. I mean, the 223 round with the research that was done actually performed really favorably in the over-penetration and the use of a home defense situation with drywall and wood and sheetrock and stuff like that. So when you bring that up, Reed, that point's actually a pretty huge point for me now that I think about it. I feel like I'm watching a political talk show and trying to be moved back and forth between sides. I'm sitting here going, well, wait a minute, that's a good idea, but I'm going to try to do that. So I think that would be, for me so far, one of the biggest benefits is that rifle power and the compact size of a AR pistol build.
Now, I think the next point here is something that, you know, I'm kind of, not real. I don't think it's a point that can't be overcome, but it's near NFA utility without the cost. So if one were going to SBR a rifle, what you essentially have is that AR-15 pistol that you would conceive of, but instead of a, you know, pistol buffer tube, you have a traditional stock buffer tube. So $200, and you know you're probably going to pay a little more for your, you know, buffer and stock than you would just a plain old pistol buffer. You know, is that a good point near NFA utility without the cost? Well, I mean, my view is, look, save up to $200. You know, do $200 less of something else, and you'll be fine. You'll be able to get your SBR. What about the weight? Well, you know what? Buck up, buttercup. You know, I don't know that I'm necessarily part of the instant gratification generation. I'm sure I've benefited from it. But, you know, I remember having to, you know, get on a bicycle and ride to the hobby store and make my weekly layaway payment on the model that I wanted to buy and take home and build. I remember those days when you had layaway. You didn't get something right now because you wanted it and you threw a fit in the middle of the mall or in the middle of, you know, Walmart, you know, in front of your mother who out of abject terror bought it for you because she could stand the humiliation. But I say buck up, buttercup, you know,
wait 4 months. I would just like to be clear on Reed's bike riding skills. To the hobby store, it was uphill both ways with two flat tires in the snow in 120 degree heat that he went to the hobby store. So just any clarification we need on that.
It wasn't that bad. I had air in the tires and it was flat. It was 120. But it was, no.
Here's one of the things that got me for those that are AR enthusiasts in the not so free states of our union, is that near NFA utility is as close as they can get to having an SBR.
And you know, that's one of the points on the list for those that can't SBR. This is close. Now, you know, here's my take on that. We talked about this. My take on that, who say, you know, I can't SBR here, but I want it, so I'll build a pistol. You know what I really think that rationale is? I want to have an SBR in case civilization collapses, because I won't be able to have UPS deliver the parts to me the day after that happens. So what I'll have in my gun safe is this perfectly legal pistol that the minute that civilization is, you know, turned on its ear, I'll be able to convert into an SBR and protect myself and my family. Okay, I get that. I get that. And you know what? I have no problem with that. But, you know, that's like having, you know, I'm gonna stockpile, you know, 1,000 rounds, you know, for the just in case go bag. Yeah, if you have 1,000 rounds that you haven't shot in 10 years, you are a sad person. you need to be able to use that ammo. It's there for that purpose, you know. Okay, have an extra 1,000 rounds, but go rotate it all the time. But, you know, why would you have something that you can't really use the way you want to? I understand. I don't disagree. I feel for you. But that's really all I see it as, because I don't know that you're going to get your SBR utility. And if you are going to get your SBR utility in a non-SBR state, it's because you're breaking the law. It's because, you know, in those, you know, meadows and places you can go and shoot without being observed, you're going to pull that buffer tube off and stick a, you know, stock on, you're going to shoot it, and you're going to, you know, be all jazzed that you could do it, and you know, got one up on a man. And but, you know, I just don't know that that's wise. And I also don't know that having something in the gun safe you're never going to use until civilization collapses and you get to convert it. I mean, you know, my dad always used to tell me, you know, keep waiting for your ship to come in, your pier's going to rust off. So it might be waiting a long time before the exact right events occur where you can do that without a repercussion. But, you know, I get it. If you can't have an SBR in your state and this is the closest you can get, okay. You know, here's another point, that it is a configuration more readily used in a PDW capacity, personal defense weapon. You know, the old movies of you know, the 80s era Secret Service, you know, with loop slings and dangling Uzis, sure, you know, kind of doing that, you know, tension extension, you know, 3-point hold is something that they would train those men to use, and it's something you can do with the AR. Of course, the two are distinctly different. You know, a 900 round a minute Uzi, or however fast they are, you know, held like that is not a precision instrument. It's supposed to lay down suppressing fire. You know, it's supposed to, you know, throw an enormous amount of lead into a situation that you can't control. All right. But that's not what an AR's utility is. It's not why we have the AR, and it's not really something that I think in this instance it's going to have any utility, unless you get yourself a, you know, a full auto lower. I mean, but really at that point, if you can buy a full auto lower you shouldn't be listening to this show. You shouldn't be worrying about a pistol caliper build. In fact, you can put a short-barreled upper on a registered lower just because. So, but, you know, I think that's the utility, and it doesn't quite get you to that place, but it is still the same form factor that I think you would look for, something that you could hang from a sloop, a loop on your shoulder, you know, at your side, and, you know, bring to bear with, you know, 30 rounds of, you know, 5.56 love that you're going to share with some folks. And you know, I think another thing that I've really always been intrigued by, and, you know, I think JD, doesn't New Frontier have a pistol configuration that has no buffer tube?
Yeah, it's their X-Star pistol that they have.
The other one that I like is the Rock River. It's a piston-driven Rock River in a pistol configuration. I'm not sure the model number. Maybe JD can help us out there for a sec. But the point is that at the end of the receiver, the rifle ends. What they've managed to do is put the recoil spring within the mechanism through which the modified bolt travels. And my guess is it's a very AK-esque configuration because the AK doesn't have a buffer tube and spring. The spring is in the piston rod. So I think it's a very similar construction, but what it affords is a pistol that in that configuration is that much shorter than what we would see as a traditional AR-15 pistol with a buffer tube. And there are some things that are compelling about that form factor in terms of the things that we've talked about, compact size, PDW, and, you know, it's still a very, it's an SBR, it's an SBR-esque platform. You know, if you could find a folding stock that would mount on it, you have almost the exact same format as some of the old AKs that you see in the movies. So it's an LARPDS. And so that's a piston-driven system. And their pistol, I mean, it's really a compelling form. I think it's an interesting look. I like the look much better than I like the look of an AR-15 pistol with a buffer tube at the end. I don't like the price. It's a little pricey. but, you know, I understand what you're buying. So that's kind of where I see the what's the point element here. It certainly is not everybody's cup of tea. You have to have arrived at a place where you're driven this way. And so I think these are, in my rough guess, some of the high points on why you would be driven this way.
So with that, we're going to take a break for just a couple seconds and play you something. And we'll be back right after this. All right. Once again, that New Frontier Armory giveaway, the 9mm carbine, you can find a link to that in our show notes. Also at firearms.tv, click on the AR-15 podcast page or at facebook.com/AR-15 podcast. As we pick up our episode on the AR-15 pistol, we've already covered basically what's the difference between an AR pistol and an AR-15. What's the point? And now, where does it fit in practical use, in day-to-day situations, in your gun collection? So, Reed, where would an AR-15 pistol fit in with your needs?
You know, I think probably the biggest aspect of it would be that compact truck gun. You know, We had an episode where we discussed the truck gun in terms of, you know, what considerations we would put into it. And, you know, I don't think we really kind of, you know, lit onto the idea of having a, you know, AR-15 pistol in that role. But if you take a look at that Rock River PDS pistol, that is a very compact form. And in that barrel length, which I think it's under 10 or right at 10. I mean, that's
nine actually, Reed.
You see, I think that's a really good length in terms of what we're talking about here. You know, I think in the 5.56, I think speculation is you're not going to get quite a full burn at 9 inches, but for what you're shooting at in a pistol roll, you're talking near distance. You're not talking, you know, hundreds. You know, you might be talking tens of yards. I think you're well within your operating parameters, and frankly, so it spits a little fire. It's kind of intimidating already, and you want some intimidation if you're going to have to pull it out and use it. So, I mean, I think a compact truck gun, that role is ideally suited to this thing. And you mentioned something about the laws in your state, which I think are compelling in that particular aspect. Tell me about the issue of a loaded rifle being near and at hand.
Yeah, when we travel, you cannot have a loaded rifle in your vehicle. You can have a loaded pistol. Of course, it works with CCW laws and things like that here in the state of Nevada. But having the rifle loaded is a no-go. In fact, just to be safe when we do transport weapons or go out to the desert or the range, I keep them completely separate. Sometimes the ammo rides in the back of the truck in the bed, and the rifles are inside the cab just to give that extra step of separation, because sometimes, you know, generally our police and our state troopers are really knowledgeable about the law. There are other branches of law enforcement that patrols government lands that I don't want to get on anybody's hate list, but had some rough stuff with, and they don't always know the law with things, and, you know, keeping it separated has been a way to diffuse those things. So you can't have, you know, your rifle loaded, but as a truck gun, this isn't a rifle. It'd be a pistol. So you'd be able to have that loaded. Now, of course, concealed carry laws and that thing would apply also wherever you're at in your vehicle. But for me, I have one of those. I'm able to have a concealed weapon. And that's a good point to have that compact truck gun in there. You know, that LAR from Rock River, only 5 pounds, 18 inches. That's a good, you know, be able to mount that. The X-Star from New Frontier Armory, also 18 inches. And in fact, fully loaded, just 4 pounds. So, I mean, you've got some pretty cool options if that's the way you wanted to go with one of these AR pistols, to be able to have it as a truck gun. And, you know, of course, as always, make sure you check your local laws. I am not an attorney. I don't even play one on the radio, but, you know, just be safe with what you're doing and know your local laws before you decide to throw a rifle or a pistol in as a truck gun. So.
Now we talked about this, of course, earlier, but in terms of where does it fit in, this configuration is tantamount to a substitute for an SBR or a, you know, a transition element to go from, you know, purchase to SBR. Either point I think is valid, and it addresses the, you know, for those who can SBR, you know, that kind of near NFA utility. So it fits in with those people who are in that space where that is the role they're trying to fulfill. And for whatever reason, whether it be, you know, it's not yet time to put the stock on because the stamp hasn't arrived, or it's never going to arrive because your state isn't going to let you ask for one. Mm-hmm. It is capable of sitting in that space to, you know, keep its pistol form, you know, till the end of time, or wait until the time is right to transition to a legal or acceptable new form. And Reed, you know what? That's okay.
And Reed, that was one of the big when we talked about AR pistols with those on Facebook and Instagram, that was the big thing, the transition. You know, it's just a placeholder until I can get this. So that was one of the big responses from everybody that's had the experience with the pistol, that moving, waiting for, you know, that email that to come back to say that it's been approved and you can start working on your SBR. So, I mean, if you invest the parts in the upper and you have everything, of course, be careful with that too, with where you're at in the whole process. Especially when you're working with an NFA item, you know, you're able to have some useful parts and while you're waiting that, I think the general wait time right now I've heard is about 4 months. You're able to do something with it. If you can't just put it in the safe and forget about it. Thankfully I was able to just put it in the safe. I actually had it in a safe at my place of work and totally forgot about it until I got the email from the ATF. So.
Now, I think there's another relevant point to this, and I don't know that there's too much utility, because frankly, if you're bitten by the black rifle disease bug, you need more than one. But if you start out with an AR pistol, it was originally, which is the language from the code that's tracking the code, it was originally intended to be a pistol. It can go from pistol to rifle without the ATF blinking an eye. Now, of course, it's a fully, you know, 18-inch rifle. I mean, a 16-inch barreled rifle. You'll have to pardon me, folks. My children are knocking. JD, we'll just have to mark this in the show notes for a little bit of editing. Hold on a second.
No way. This is where they're going to come in and ask you for an AR pistol, man. I want to see this.
You know, it's hard to explain to a five-year-old what it is you're doing on the internet with that camera and the microphone. He just doesn't quite understand how this goes beyond this here and now space, but that's all right.
I don't think we shared the link to watch. So if somebody out there is watching, they'll grab it just by random.
One of the things about the whole idea of being able to go from a pistol to the rifle is that you can take that originally configured pistol lower. You can add all of the legal components to make it a full legal rifle, and the NFA or the ATF will not have a problem with you. And then you can take it back to a pistol because it began as a pistol. And so you're not running afoul of any of their other positions. And during that whole point in time, you can get the tax stamp and get your lower receiver marked so it can be an SBR. So it fills a multitude of places. You know, of course, I would just tell you, go buy another lower and build another rifle. You know, why would you have one rifle that can be, or one lower that can be three things, when you should just have three rifles or three things, however you want to parse it. But I mean, that's something that can fit in, because I do think that there are people that they operate that way. It's going to be just what they need for the moment. They don't need two others. They're more than happy to convert it to that other place when it's time. You know, I think that in terms of where does it fit in, there are plenty of people that are just intimidated by NFA items. They're intimidated by the process. They're intimidated by what they feel the implications are, and they don't want to go that route. Okay, so with an AR-15 pistol, you can have some of the SBR perks, but without the NFA burden. Okay, I think that's a valid point. I do.
You know, as someone, I remember thinking that. I just went through the process of my trust and my first NFA item in SBR this last year. I always thought it would be this huge burden, this, you know, really a difficult process or really in depth. And if I can do it, anybody can do it. I mean, literally, when I submitted the form, I was like, it can't be that easy. It can't be this easy to do anything. I had it so built up. So if you're doing it for that reason, really talk to somebody who's had experience with submitting stuff for, you know, ATF approval, and you'll see it's not as big as, you know, I put it off for a couple of years, not wanting to deal with the headache, and then realized I'm an idiot because I missed out on a couple of years where I could have done some pretty cool stuff. So,
yeah. Well, and you know, here's the thing, you know, I think that that's probably the first knee jerk that people have when it comes to the whole idea of, you know, something that's going to be handled through the National Firearms Act requirements. But I think that there is that additional step of people who are concerned about, you know, am I on a list? You know, who's looking at me now that I have this? You know, am I going to be rounded up when the revolution comes? You know, whatever the concern is. And, you know, I would tell you that, you know, I am not as concerned about those things. You know, the fact of the matter is that when you're born and they hand you a social security number, you already are on a list. You know, it starts at birth. And the rest of it, you know, I mean, you have to find your comfort level, but I'm pretty comfortable where I am. But, you know, I think the last one is, you know, probably for many, the most important aspect of where does it fit in. And you know, that is that it's the final accessory for your ninja setup. Well, and I don't want to come across as being snarky here. And I don't mean it in that way. But you know what? I think in a lot of instances, it's a toy. I think there are plenty of us who have gone out and purchased something firearms related or even a firearm itself because it's a toy, because it's fun, because we want to, because why not? Because America, you know. But, you know, hey, where does it fit in? If you just decide that's what you want, who cares? You can get it, go get it. And so, if you just want to be able to have something that you take to the range that, you know, people are going to ask you questions about, fine. If you want to be able to take something out to your, you know, piece of land out in a, you know, rural area and just, you know, from the hip, you know, unload, you know, 30 rounds as fast as you can, or, you know, heck, if you want to, you know, hang your thumb off your belt loop and do a little bit of, you know, bump fire and see if you can, you know what it's like to empty 30 rounds out of a AR pistol, you know, just don't hurt yourself. But, you know, hey, that's what you're allowed to do, right? You'd be safe. You'd be responsible. You make sure that nobody gets hurt. And within the law, do what you want to do, right? So if you think that it's time for you to buy a new toy, go buy a new toy. You know, who are we to stand in your way? Not that we're standing in your way or anything, but so, you know, I think when it comes to where does it fit in, there is a place. And you know, yeah, I'm gonna come down on the side of saying that it does not have as much utility as the other aspects of the AR-15 that we talk about all the time. And, you know, I know that it's a bias that I hold easily because of what I do professionally, but I do not think it's a burden to get from A to B. And, you know, that, you know, we might have a bunch of listeners saying, well, yeah, easier for you to say. And I'm sorry, it is. But I don't think that it's that hard for you guys to get to the place I am, because like JD, you said, you build up this anxiety and it dissipates as soon as you get through it. And today, with so many companies, so many endeavors supporting people's journey into this kind of NFA side of things, there are a lot of resources that didn't exist 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago. They're all over the place. And so you can find a lot of help. And, you know, geez, think about it. We're coming up on our 30-year anniversary of the 86 Act.
Dang.
So it's been almost 30 years that, you know, most everybody in recent memory has had to deal with, you know, the current structure for these items. So, yeah.
You know, thinking about that, there's going to be somebody in your area that can help you through it. For my trust, it was somebody I found on Nevada Shooters. You know, most states have forums or shoot sites, and you can go check out and get kind of the lay of the land and the locals. You know, checking that is really good. For me here in Nevada, for Las Vegas, Ben Bunker was the attorney who did my trust. And man, it was, I'm telling you, building it up was horrible because I sent Ben the information. I sent him the name of the trust. 2 days later, he sends me back the stuff that I have to sign electronically, and we're all good to go. And then he also answers questions on the form for others. So there's going to be an attorney like that, or there's going to be somebody to service you in your area. Some of the other places, you know, Silencer Shop and Silencer Co., those guys have got information on trusts and all this stuff. And Silencer Shop has the change in how things went with the ATF with their, was it 41F earlier this year that's going to change this summer? So there's all sorts of information out there for you to find that will make this going to NFA items a whole lot easier and maybe remove some of that. Do I really want to jump into this pool?
Right. Well, let's move into our next piece here and talk about what do you need to consider if you're going to buy an AR-15 pistol in this kind of the context of what we've been talking about. And, you know, I think the first one is that NFA considerations are still relevant. You can't throw a stock on it. You know, my understanding is you can't put a foregrip on it, you know, an angled grip or a, you know, vertical grip. You know, you're going to have to stay within the guidelines of what the NFA says, or you could get yourself in big trouble.
Mm-hmm.
And you want to keep that in mind. You want to know what the limits are. You want to know where the borders are. You know, don't be that, you know, lab with a shot collar who just runs across the field, you know, runs across the boundary line. That NFA is serious business, and the ATF, they take care of their jobs, and you don't want to be on the wrong side of that. And, you know, here's another thing to consider. You know, I am, you know, well aware that there are plenty of guys that go out there, they buy themselves a pistol, they take it home, and as fast as they can get out their Castle Nut wrench, they're pulling the buffer tube off and putting a stock on it. They're going to thumb their nose at the ATF. They're going to thumb their nose at the man. And frankly, thumbing your nose at the man rarely ends well.
For you,
for anybody. I just don't do it. So, you know what? You need to consider that. You know, the guys that get hammered by these things, they get hammered hard. It's not fun stuff. So, you know, if you want to thumb your nose at the man, frankly, I'd rather work in the system, pay $200 than be able to stand there all day long with that thing hanging on a sling and telling them what, you know what I mean? They can't do anything to you then. All it costs is $200. So just keep that in mind. Now, you know, I think this is something that for me is particularly valid. And that is the idea that your money is tied up in this build. If you're not going to use it, if you're going to wait until the revolution comes, if you're not able to pull it out of the gun safe because you did put a stock on it, what are you doing? You just tied up all that money into this build, and it's never going to have that use like you might take your regular carbine to the range and get, like you might have for your, you know, your long range setup, you know, whatever the case may be, your you're eliminating some of that money that you have available to put together a build that you might be able to use whenever and wherever you want. So consider that. You know, I think the last and probably the biggest thing here is the notion of practicality versus novelty. You know, I get it. Novelty is great. It goes back to that toy thing. We all want the toy. You know what I really want? I want a can launcher. I want an X Products can launcher. I'm going to put it on one of my SBR lowers, and I'm going to shoot Coke cans, you know, across the deer lease. You know, maybe shoot them into the pond next to the guys that play their music loud opening morning because they don't like the thought of deer dying. I mean, why do you move to Texas if you grew up in New York? Really? I mean, does that make any sense, JD?
It doesn't.
I don't get it. Anyway, so I mean, the point is I want one of those. I haven't bought one yet. I don't know when I'm going to get one, but I want one because it's a neat toy. I get it. But, you know, I don't know how practical an AR-15 pistol is. If you're going to say, I'm going to use it in the same way I'd use any other pistol, I guarantee you it's more practical to get a SIG or a Beretta or a Glock or a Smith & Wesson, you know, Springfield XD, whatever. Those are far more practical than an AR-15 pistol to be used as pistols. I mean, I just don't think you're ever going to convince me otherwise. And I think most people would probably admit the same thing. They would concede that point. Can the AR-15 pistol do something more that a pistol can't? Yeah, probably. Probably. We could sit here and make a list of those things, but you know, I'm not going to. So I think that's a big consideration. What is the practical nature of that configuration versus its novelty? Which one is the bigger factor? Which one outweighs the other? So, you know, I think with that, we've got a pretty basic thumbnail sketch of the AR-15 pistol. In terms of the fundamentals of what it would take to put one together, frankly, I don't think it's any different than any of the other things we've talked about in our build shows. You're talking about the same platform. You're just getting different parts that have a different utility, and so you might have to figure out how they're going to work together nice, but same considerations. Torque wrenches, this, pull up, you know, drift pins, that, punches and wrenches galore. After that, you're good. So, you know, we'll put a couple of references to old episodes for a build so that you can link to them if you want to actually put together your AR-15 pistol with our help. But, you know, really, I think these are the big things that you have to go through if this is the route you're going to go, because you can buy off the shelf and find plenty of resources that will help you build them. But I'm pretty sure the guy trying to make a commission on selling you one isn't going to give you any negatives. So any thoughts about this, JD? Have you decided you're swayed one way or the other in this political environment?
Well, the thing with the AR pistol was it was actually on my list to buy. And that was before I built my first SBR. Once I built that and shot it, the AR pistol kind of disappeared from it. It may still be on my list down there, but I have a safe full of lowers, as Reed can attest to. And none of them are designated for a pistol build. I just think it's really going to come down to, you know, if you're at a point where you're like, man, this would be cool to have and mess around with, that it's going to be good for you. But if you're looking for a function of something, it's really going to have to fit into like a unique niche for you to want to do it and for it to pay off as a build. For me, it just got bumped way down the list. Shooting that first SBR with, you know, I have a 10.5-inch barrel and a 300 blackout. I can't imagine putting money into a pistol build when I could put money into another SBR.
You know, for just a minute there, I thought you were going to label me the destroyer of dreams. I'm glad that you, through your first decision to build an SBR out there on the block as the destroyer of dreams. You know, if I had the extra money laying around, would I get one in the traditional sense that we always see them? No, I don't think so. If I had the money laying around, would I buy like one of the Rock River PDSs? You know, yes, probably. Would it be a novelty? Yes. Would I keep it for long? I couldn't tell you. Probably not for very long at all. But, you know, if I had that much money laying around that was not otherwise, you know, identified for a specific purpose, and of course I'd have to buy a purse of equal value, so that really makes it a, you know, that's a, you know, way off of my radar screen kind of deal. You know, yeah, I can get one. But none of these other items are ever going to compel me to get there. And part of its circumstance, part of its taste, part of its ability, part of its, you know, just random chance that I'm living in the place I am. So I'm not compelled. And I don't find many of the arguments compelling. So that's kind of where I am. And frankly, I think that you're better off being absolutely certain in what you're doing than to find yourself dissatisfied that you've done it and not being able to undo the journey you've taken. So I guess that's my two cents.
And that wraps up the AR-15 pistol part of this episode, episode 164. We talked about the 9mm carbine giveaway at the front of the show from New Frontier Armory. We want to say thanks to them for partnering up with us. Also, I want to get over to the Facebook page real quick. You can find a link to sign up there, facebook.com/AR15podcast. You can also go to the show notes of episode 164 and be able to find the link there. You can go to firearmsradio.tv and click on the AR15 podcast portion of the site, and you'll be able to sign up there. There's a link there. I also want to thank RTT Firearms. They're going to do a custom job on the 9mm carbine. I was looking at some of their stuff today. Robert and Evelyn have a good shop down there in Lake Havasu City, Arizona. So we thank them for that. And now, since Reed won't let me have like a Reed's reaction section of the show in the beginning, I'm going to start asking you guys for questions for Reed, because he can answer them in only a way that Reed will. And this one came from Jody. Jody's one of the three gunners that checks in with us from time to time on social media. And he wants Reed's reaction to this story. So the story came out last year about a young soldier dying of a massive erection because he was so excited about shooting a 50 caliber machine gun. True story. Has Reed ever gotten that excited? Can't believe I just asked you that. And well, almost that excited while shooting a particular gun. If so, what gun was it, Reed?
You know, I started shooting when I was 8. So I kind of liken my love and appreciation for firearms this way. You know, it's kind of like an 8-year-old piano player in a New Orleans whorehouse. By the time you figure out what's going on, it doesn't faze you anymore. So, no, I've never gotten that direction. I don't know that I could tell you that there is one gun that is, you know, more impressive than another in that way. I guess that's the other thing about that 8-year-old piano player. He understands how broad the field is. So,
well, there you go, Jody. Next up from LCR, I heard your discussion about the changes to the Marine Corps shooting program. And part of the misunderstanding I see is discussed in the Marine Corps Times, aka the Marine Corps Inquirer, matched together multiple years where the marksmanship synopsises and quite a bit of
symposiums.
Symposiums. Quite a bit of conjuncture. I am being graded on this. During the M16A4/M4 PIP, there was a proposal to field a new upper receiver group with a free float rail without a fixed front sight. Currently, that's on hold because of costs and current initiatives to equip all and re-equip all infantry and infantry-like units with only M4s. Since 2008, all of our new guns did not come with carry handles. They came with backup iron sights initially made by MATEC. In 2010, the Marine Corps started buying KAC 600mm backup sights, and there were problems with its fielding because it did not come with any support of doctrine to support the backup iron sights, so many of them walked off over the years. In 2012, the Marine Corps decided to use only RCO and the entry-level pipeline. This was based on numerous studies and feedback from the field that Marines could not shoot the RCOs all that well, and most did not understand them. This would tie to, one, the optical sighted weapon is the primary means of using it. If iron sights, the weapon is in a degraded mode of operation. Two, did you hear that? A degraded mode of operation? You have no comment over there?
No, he's absolutely true.
You know, okay, two.
Not to use the RCO, they're only using the backup iron sight when the RCO doesn't work.
Most Marines learned to shoot in the Marines. Three, all their initial training was on irons. Four, because the rule of primacy, they understood irons. I just got lost. I'm going to have to edit that. Irons. Five, it takes 2 to 3 times longer to retain a new item as it does in their initial training. So why spend the 2 total weeks of training on the degraded mode of operation when most shooters will never get the time required to retain them their primary means of shooting the weapon? What this really means, what really killed the irons at recruit training was after they studied recruits, it's at TBS, and demonstrated all that ROC shooters, training shooters could still qualify with backup iron sights. And LCR, I completely butchered that. So I hope I was able to get your point across and the information that came through. Next time, read. You are reading anything that has to do with Marine speak and not leaving the civilian out there to struggle and drown on the island.
Well, you know, I think it was good watching you drown a little bit.
Thanks. Appreciate that. I'll send you an AR pistol for Christmas.
You know, I do want to thank LCR for sending this in. You know, we don't always get the best picture out here when we're not, you know, in the fray. And I am glad that our listeners do share their perspectives, their experiences, and their viewpoints, because every one of those viewpoints is valuable. And that experience, once again, goes back to the original core of what we are here to do. We are here to share information, because that's the only way that we demystify what we love to do and make it okay. Thank you, LCR. We appreciate you. Absolutely. Why don't you read the next one? There's no very complex lingo in here.
Thank you. You're going to have to pay for Hooked on Phonics for me after this is all done. I feel like my tongue's twisted. Ian writes in, "Hello, men. I wanted to write to tell you all how much I enjoy listening to the podcast the last few months. I wish I would have known about the show sooner, but I'm working hard to catch up on past episodes. I got back into shooting 3 years ago, and the AR platform quickly became my top priority. One off-the-shelf purchase and 3 builds later, I show no signs of slowing. I regret the almost 5-year break I took from shooting after the military. I just wanted to tell you guys, keep up the good work, and I appreciate the product that you put out each week." Thank you very much, Ian. Thank you for your service too. I understand that break though a little bit. Sometimes that break from shooting happens.
The fact that we have listeners that send this stuff in, just it really makes it nice, because it makes it easier to do what we do, and being supported by the listeners is you know, I think it's probably not as common as it ought to be, but it's very common here, and it makes us truly understand, you know, how we're blessed, how we're given an opportunity to get in there and just really create a good community. And frankly, guys, I'll tell you, that's what motivates us to go out and try to do the things we do for you. I mean, that's why we are really, you know, busting our humps to get these giveaways in place so that we can say thank you, because we wouldn't be here if it weren't for you. And, you know, we wouldn't be able to sit here and have the fun we do if you didn't want to listen to us. So thanks again. We appreciate it. Thank you all.
Absolutely. And if you have any questions, comments, show topics, ideas, you want to yell at one of us, you're more than welcome to. You can shoot us an email. It is ar15.podcast@gmail.com. That's ar15.podcast@gmail.com. You guys feel the show. I mean, it is great to interact with everybody. And I've, you know, now been here for 7 months and learned so much from the feedback and the things that come in. It's just a great way for me to grow also too, as somebody who's a firearms and an AR-15 enthusiast. So that email again, ar15.podcast@gmail.com. You can also send us, I don't know if we have that SpeakPipe plugged in on the right-hand side of the AR-15 podcast website anymore. I will double check that here in a little bit. One thing you can do for us, and you guys, Reed will agree, they've been phenomenal, is on iTunes. The reviews you guys have left for the AR-15 podcast, you guys smoke every other gun podcast out there. You guys smoke most podcasts. We're up over 500 reviews, and you look at the other ones, the big boys that do a bunch of stuff and different things and giveaways and have partnerships, they got like 50 reviews. So once again, you guys driving it. And when you leave us one of those reviews on iTunes, it helps the show place higher in searches for potential listeners that are looking to learn about their favorite black rifle. Share your pictures with us on Instagram at AR15 Podcast. I'd love to repost some of your guys' builds, the things you guys are doing with firearms. It'd be great to share that with the community. Tag your pictures with the hashtag AR15 Podcast. Visit us on Facebook, facebook.com/AR15 Podcast. Check out the other great podcasts on the Firearms Radio Network. And don't forget to use the Brownells link for all your AR-15 parts needs. That is now at Firearms Radio, firearmsradionetwork.tv. It is the AR-15 podcast link is right there on the front of the page. You can just click it there and it'll take you to our Brownells affiliate link. That is at firearmsradio.tv. And make sure you also use the Amazon affiliate link there too. Reed, as we wrap up episode 164, is there anything you'd like to close out with?
I would. Tom G, you know, for the man that contacts us every 4 to 5 minutes on a regular basis, how long did it take you to sign up for the giveaway? A little disappointed with your attention. So, Tom, we want you to straighten up and fly right. Everybody else, have a great week. We'll be back soon. Thanks. Bye.
This has been a production of the Firearms Radio Network. You can find more information at firearmsradio.tv.